Good morning and happy Sabbath. Welcome to First Seventh-day Adventist Church, where healing happens one heart at a time. We are so glad that you decided to join us this early morning for our service today. Those of you who are watching online, we thank you so much for tuning in. I just have a few announcements before we get into our service. April 27th, Youth Nature Sabbath will be on the Green Mountain. Registration deadline is April the 20th, so you need to look at the website and Facebook for more details on that. Again, April 27th is the Youth Nature Sabbath, and there will be the deadline, April 20th. So all parents, pay attention to that. On Monday produce giveaway, 3 to 4:30. And on Wednesday, we have a lot of things happening on Wednesday. Wednesday, youth rehearsal at 5:15. Children's rehearsal is 5:30. Noon Pop has a new series that takes place at 12 noon on Wednesday. The series is Sabbath Keeping Benefits. Then also on Wednesday at 6:30, Bible study series. A new series is coming up, If My People Pray, and that is at 6:30. On Thursday, choir rehearsal, Unity Choir Rehearsal, 6:15, and the chorale at 6:30 on Thursday. Then on Friday, another choir rehearsal for the chorale at 6:15. So to stay updated with all of the announcements, be sure to peruse the website. Also go to Facebook and you will see those announcements there as well. We have a wonderful, wonderful service today, but I want to go back. Do you all remember last week? If you were here last Sabbath, oh my goodness. Last Sabbath, Pastor Lee preached a sermon that had me in a chokehold, okay? We learned last Sabbath. Let's recap before we get into service today. We learned on last Sabbath that the word hedge is used for weaving. Okay, Pastor Lee told a story about a lady who got shot in the head. And the bullet did not, she got hit in the head with a bullet, and she survived. Y'all remember he told that story? He went on to say that when she was asked how did she survive, she didn't know, but her response was that she had just left the salon and she had gotten her hair done and had gotten a weave. Y'all, let me tell you, that thing had me, and I went right out, and I got my hedge of protection, okay? You're not gonna catch me slipping, all right? So I encourage you all to get you a hedge of protection, also known as some weave, okay? Protection. All right, so let's get into our service today. We are excited to have a guest pastor, Pastor Jason North from Southwest Region Conference. That's my childhood conference, so we're excited to have him here join us. The Mass Choir is in the building. We're excited for the Mass Choir, and we are also excited to share this worship experience with you. First Church family, it is time for worship.
Anybody know God will give to you good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall God give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you give, it shall be measured back to you.
Praise the Lord, First Church. Come on, praise the Lord, First Church. Come on, I'm so excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Come on, anybody excited this weekend, Easter weekend, Resurrection weekend? Come on, why don't you rest on your feet this morning as we go forth in worship? Hallelujah. Come on, the song says, hallelujah, he has won the victory. Come on, do you believe that this morning? God, we bless your great name. Yeah, 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 yeah. Hallelujah, you have won the victory. Oh, hallelujah, you have won it all for me by his stripes. We are healed by his nail-pierced hands. We're free. Come on, do you believe it this morning? By his blood, we're washed clean. Now we have the victory. Oh, the power of sin. Jesus overcame it all. Yes, you came it all, Lord. Thank you, God. Oh, he has won our freedom. Jesus has won it all. Oh, say hallelujah. Our Savior, he hung and died
you
for
us.
Won the victory, he reigns on high. Help and say,
my God is risen.
He is alive.
He is alive.
He's won
the victory.
He reigns on high.
He reigns on high.
Our God is risen.
God is risen.
He is
alive.
He's won the victory.
The victory.
And he reigns.
He reigns on high.
My God is risen.
He is alive.
He won the victory. Yes, he has. Yes, he has.
Death could not hold you.
Death could not hold
have won the victory. Oh, hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Yeah. You ought to lift them right there. Come on, it's resurrection weekend. You ought to lift them right there. Because he's worthy. Yes, he is.
If you know he's good, come on, give God some praise in the sanctuary this morning. Come on, you know that God is risen from the dead. I tell you right now to give God your best hallelujah, your best thank you, Jesus. I read this morning that his death certificate became my birth certificate. Come on, somebody, hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Surely he is worthy to be praised. Amen, amen. We welcome you on this glorious Sabbath. You may be seated in the presence of a good and gracious God. Anybody glad to be in God's house on a Sabbath morning? Ooh-wee, I'm glad to be in God's house today. I've come to lift his name up, amen, and to give his name glory, honor, and praise. Listen, I won't be before you long today. So I want to say welcome today. Welcome to every single last one of you all today in the sanctuary, to those who are watching us online as well. We welcome you. We are so glad that you got up this morning, amen, and came to the sanctuary to indeed enjoy and to bless the name of our good and gracious God. I do want to take a moment today to welcome our guests today. Some of, we don't call you visitors, we call you our guests because we just want to treat you as such. We love you, you're part of the body of Christ, and we just want to love on you today. So listen, if you are not a member here at First Seventh-day Adventist Church, would you just wave at me right now? Come on, wave at me right now. I see all these hands. God bless you. Amen, amen. I love it today. All right, praise God, praise God. Listen, we're so excited today. I want to take this moment on behalf of myself and our pastoral staff to welcome you all on today. It's going to be a great, great morning in the Lord. I do want to just highlight, I see some folk that have come from near and far, and it's so good to see you all in the house of God today. I see my Indianapolis crew today in the house. God bless you. So good to see y'all today. Amen, amen. Miss Melissa, this is the mother of Bryce Davis. Melissa, would you please stand today? Would you please stand? This is the mother of Bryce Davis. Now, there he is. There he is. I need Bryce. Now, he was recognized on last night. Come on, say amen. He was the youngest honoree in Oakwood University history. Come on, y'all. Let's celebrate our very own. He's a member here at First Seventh-day Adventist Church, and we honor and praise God for you, Bryce Davis. You do it well, and we're just so excited for the great things the Lord will continue to do in your life. I have not seen, and ear have not heard, and we just praise God today. Listen, hey, Brother Ryan Smith, it's good to see you, sir. Dean, Vice President, all that and above, good to see you back home today. Amen. I'm looking around. Pastor Fordham, Sister Fordham, so good to see you all in the house of God. Come on, praise God for each one of these individuals today. Amen. Now, listen, I know y'all came to worship, so I want y'all to stand up right now. Come on, stand up right now. Stand up right now. The praise team, they're going to come right back, and the choir's going to sing right now. I need for y'all to turn to somebody right now. Give somebody a hug. Give somebody a handshake. Say, listen, it is good to see your face in this place today. Welcome those who are online as well. God bless you as we praise the Lord today.
Come bless the Lord,
come bless the Lord, come bless the Lord. Join in to worship, praise the Lord, and bless his name, his holy name, declaring
he is the Lord.
Oh, that men would praise him. Oh, that men would praise him.
Rejoice!
The Lord always, and again. The Lord always, and again I say,
Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Amen. Well, again, welcome today. Welcome. God bless you on this glorious Sabbath morning. Listen, I need to go to a couple of shout-outs this morning. I'll get out of your way today. You've heard most of the announcements. Let me just say this. On next Sabbath, everybody, next Sabbath is our Holy Communion Sabbath. Come on, somebody say amen. We are excited about that. We are excited about that today. So we want to continue to prepare our hearts and our minds for next Sabbath. We continue with our normal schedule on next Sabbath. So please come and join us, join us, join us. Hey, today is a special day. I need to shout out today. Hey, today is my son's birthday. Yes, sir. He's already standing up. So we might as well come on down real quick. Come on down. Come on real quick. He was already standing up. He's in the back. I don't know. He was trying to sneak out somewhere. I don't know where he was going. Hey, today he is celebrating 18 years of life. Hey, happy birthday. Yes, sir. Man, this is so great today. 18 years. I can't believe it. I can't believe 18 years. I just remember like it was yesterday when he was coming on out. Yeah. And now he didn't got all big, got all this going on, whatever this stuff is. I just want to recognize him, man. Today, we sung this morning. My wife reminded me last night that today is Mother's Day. You know, y'all, all these women hating right now. It is Mother's Day. Listen, we want to say congratulations to you, sir. He's about grown. Amen. He's grown-ish. Amen. Grown-ish. Well, he ain't too big. He ain't too big. Come on, some father better holler at me right now. Because we know as a daddy, we still will put you down. Amen. In Jesus' name. I'm going to let them know in front of everybody today. Man, congratulations, sir. God bless you, man. Amen. Hey, there's a Cash App. Go on Facebook. Go and bless the brother. Amen. Go and bless the brother. That's what I really wanted to say. Amen. So he can pay his own cell phone bill. Bless him. Pay that own bill. Amen. Amen. Hey, listen, I'm so excited today. I woke up like this, y'all. I woke up turned up for Jesus Christ. I don't know about y'all. Did anybody know he lived? He died. He rose again. And one day, he that shall come will come. And will not tarry. I'm excited about that. Come on, let's stand to your feet right now as we go into worship today. Let's stand today. Amen. Every Sabbath we repeat our fourth commandment, Exodus 3:16 as well. Together, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. Thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that's in thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that are in it, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord and hallowed it. Amen. John 3:16-17. Together, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Amen. Father, in Jesus' name, God, we already sense your presence, God, in this place. So, God, today we've come for one reason and one reason alone, and that is to lift up your glorious name. God, I pray that you will receive the praises from our lips, from our hearts, oh God, from our total body and our being. Oh God, be glorified in us today, Father. Move in this worship service, God. May somebody be encouraged. May somebody be inspired. May somebody see Jesus and surrender to him. Oh God, have your way right now, for I ask all these blessings in the blessed name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ, in Jesus' name, amen. And amen. Won't you remain standing at this time?
Come on, as we celebrate Resurrection Weekend, anybody know that the blood will never lose its power? Hallelujah. Come on, all over the building.
The blood. Way back on Calvary.
Way back on Calvary.
Come on, the blood. believe that this morning, First Church. It will never lose its power. It's still flowing. It reaches from the highest mountain and flows to the lowest valley. It serves us day to day. Come on, you ought to lift them this morning. Hallelujah. My Lord, I will sing your praise.
Yes.
For you have done so many marvelous things for someone so wretched. Yet my soul you have redeemed. No one else could do it. Oh, no one could care half as much. Yet you thought my soul was worth it. So you gave your only son. Just think about that right there. But Lord, you see my accomplishment, even the good works,
even the good works you have begun in me.
Oh, you also see my finish. Oh, it's marvelous, woo! Marvelous, woo! So marvelous, it is marvelous,
marvelous.
Oh, oh, marvelous. It's marvelous.
It's marvelous.
Oh, marvelous.
It's marvelous.
Oh, marvelous.
Marvelous.
Yes, it is so marvelous.
So marvelous.
It's marvelous, so marvelous. Come on, and a man will lay down his life. Marvelous, so marvelous. When I look back over my life and see where he's brought me from. Come on, you can think it to this last week where he's brought you from. Come on, you didn't know how you was gonna make it to this week. You can just think about yesterday. You didn't know if you was gonna wake up this morning. Come on, the weight of life just carrying you down, weighing you down. Come on, it's marvelous. Oh, marvelous. Oh, no, 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 no. What a wonderful thing.
What a wonderful thing.
No, 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 no. What a glorious thing.
What a glorious thing.
What a marvelous thing. Yeah.
What a marvelous thing.
You've done. Now that you know he's been marvelous, why don't you lift up this morning? Come on, why don't you praise him this morning while he's been standing right here? Come on, if today was the day that we saw our Savior face to face, why don't you show him how you would treat him? Why don't you show him how you would love on him? Why don't you show him how you would say thank you for dying for you, for raising you up? Come on, why don't you say thank you, Lord? Lord, I love you. Lord, I bless you. We give you glory this morning because you're worthy. What a marvelous thing he's done. What a marvelous thing he's done. Only he could do it.
About to have me forget that I'm not preaching today, so let me evacuate that from my mind immediately. You may be seated. It's prayer time. Mercy. It's marvelous. What a glorious thing he has done. I was doing my devotion this morning, and in my devotion, I don't know if you do the Bible app, they have this time where you go through the season of reflective prayer. And so I'm laying out these things that I need God to work out. And he reminded me when my wife and I went on vacation the last time, we were on the beach in the Dominican Republic. We had been stuck on the boat for 5 days. The first time we was able to get off the boat because it had stormed so bad. And so we're just trying to enjoy some sunshine. We're just trying to enjoy the sand. And so we're sitting in the free seats because there's the cheap seats. Then there's the paid for canopies, and then there's the free seats. We were in the free seats trying to make the most out of a palm tree to pretend that it was our covering. A lady and her baby got up and they saw us huddled under the palm tree. And they said, here, you can have our canopy. We're done with it. We're going back to the boat. And you can sit here until it's time to go home. So for the rest of that day, whether it was drizzle, we were covered under the canopy. Whether it was blazing hot in the sun, we were covered under that canopy. Whether the wind was blowing to and fro, we were covered under that canopy. And so the Lord spoke to me this morning and asked me to remind you, just like he reminded me, that whatever you're going through, you are covered under the canopy of Christ. Whether it's the storms of life, whether it's the sunny days of frustration, whatever it is you're going through, or your children or your parents are going through, it is covered under the canopy of Christ. So as we pray today, I just want you to remember that you are indeed covered. Let us pray. Blessed Father in heaven, we come before you. Lord, thanking you for your blanket of protection as we laid there last night. The devil did battle with you and lost because we are here. Lord, we know that Satan was defeated because we're here to sing, we're here to shout, we're here to praise your name and to hear the word that you've given Pastor North for us today. So Lord, we simply say thank you for being our hiding place. We say thank you for preserving us from the trouble that Satan tried to bring to our doorstep. We say thank you for your deliverance, Lord. And not only last night, but the last 7 days. But Lord, some of us have burdens that are weighing us down. Some of us come here, Lord, and we are overwhelmed by what awaits us when we leave these doors. So Lord, we simply ask that you be a covering in whatever area we need protection and provision from. Lord, whether it is our body that is raging war against us, whether it is sickness that is taking over us or a loved one, Lord, we simply ask that you be a covering and provide restoration and recovery. Lord, we ask that you be a covering for the finances that go to the doctor bills and the finances that go to the medical bills, Lord, that you will make a way out of no way and make a dollar out of 15 cents. Lord, some of us are having civil wars within our households, Lord, and we have promised till death do us part, and it seems sometimes like our marriage may be killing us. So, Lord, we simply ask that you be a covering. Be a covering for husband. Be a covering for wife, Lord. Be a covering for the children that you have given us and entrusted us to, Lord. We simply return them to you now. For they are way better in your hands than they ever were in ours. Lord, we ask that you be with those that are in the valley of decision, those that are looking for peace, those that are searching and seeking and are running everywhere but right back to you. So like the commission song, Lord, we simply ask that you speak to them and let them see that you've been exactly where they are and they choose you this day. Father, I ask lastly that you will be with the man of the hour. Cover him, Lord. Shroud him in your spirit, Lord, that he is enveloped in you and that the only thing that comes forth from this microphone is exactly what you have given him for such a time as this and such a people as us. You brought him on this day for this appointed hour, so Lord, use him completely until he is no more. Forgive us, Lord, for our sins and our shortcomings, and if today is our last day, let us hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant, as you take us back to your heavenly home. In Christ's mighty name we pray, amen.
I have a story for you. It's true, but it's somewhat anecdotal. We have 3 grown children. And our oldest child, when he worked, when he was in high school, he got his first check. And he was so excited. He came home and he said, Dad, I got my first check. I said, boy, let me take a look at that thing. So he gave it to me. And I put it in my pocket and I walked away from him. He said, Dad, that's my check. It's mine. I work for that. I kept on walking. He said, that's stealing. So I went to Psalm 24 because this thing hurt me. And Psalm 24 tells me that the earth is mine and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Then I went down into Malachi 3. See, he called me a thief. And that hurt me. Says, will a man rob God? He said, yes, you're a thief. And that hurt me. Then I went to 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 10. And it said to me, now this one really got me. It says, there will be no thieves in heaven. So I gave him his money back. Don't give God your money because you don't want to go to hell. I invite the deacons to come for this morning's offering. Let us pray. We give thee but thine own, whatever it might be. All that we have is thine, O Lord, a gift, O Lord, from thee. Amen.
The song that we're going to sing this morning is a familiar song to this church. It talks about God's keeping power. And Bryce and team just sang about how marvelous the Lord is. And I'm truly believe that because he's marvelous, he's kept me through it all. The bad times, the good times, the sad times. And so we're going to sing, God kept me this morning. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, did God keep you? Look at the other person you ain't talked to and say, neighbor, did God keep you? And I promise you, by the end of the day, you'll be singing this song in your sleep. All right, let's go, band. Part talks about being in your right mind, and every now and then I feel like I ain't in my right mind, but I'm grateful that I got it. And so you kind of got the gist of the song, but this next part says, I'm in my right mind. Why don't you sing with us? Here we go. One more. Some of y'all got some aches, some pains, but you're sitting right here this morning. Amen. It may have been a struggle getting in the door, but you're sitting right here this morning. So the next part talks about I got my health and my strength. And I want you to believe that this morning, that through all the arthritis and diabetes and all that headaches and stuff, you still have your health and strength. All right? So let's make one big choir and say, I have my health. Here we go.
I'm so by this point. If you believe it, why don't you say, sing, oh! God kept me.
God kept me.
Y'all think the best singers up here, but they really out there. Let's try that again. Say, oh!
You this morning. I say, anybody glad God kept you this morning? He kept me. He kept me. He kept me. Anybody know he's a keeper this morning? He's a keeper. He's a keeper. Amen. Amen. Listen, I am super excited today to introduce my brother, my friend, my homeboy, my colleague, literally one of my best friends. I'm so happy today. Can y'all put y'all hands together even right now for Pastor Jason C. North. I am so excited today to have this preacher. He is a mighty preacher, and I'm excited to have him in the house of God today. We have served together for years in the Great Lake Region Conference. I looked around today. I saw some Lake Region folk in the house today. Lake Region in the house today. It's so good to see each one of y'all today. Listen, we are so excited to have each one of y'all. Amen. God bless you all today. See some of your church from your home church as well. Amen. Well, listen today. Pastor Jason C. North is from Montgomery, Alabama. Yes, indeed. Amen. Amen. He spent his first 12 years of life moving around due to his father being a lieutenant colonel in the United States Air Force. Come on, say amen. At the age of 12, his father retired from active duty, and the North moved to Berrien Springs, Michigan, where Pastor North considers that to be his hometown. Pastor Jason C. North holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Physical Education from Oakwood University in Huntsville, Alabama, as well as a Master of Arts degree in Youth Ministry from Andrews University Theological Seminary in Berrien Springs, Michigan. Pastor North is married to the love of his life, the beautiful Miss Angie Corriton. Would you please stand up right now? She is, I know it, I know it, I know it. God, come on, y'all put your hands together for the first lady today. God bless you, Sister Angie. She hails from Bermuda, amen. We're so excited about that. Pastor North began his professional career as a K-12 physical education teacher at Bermuda Institute and Bermuda Conference. He then served as a chaplain, a Bible and PE teacher at Grand Rapids Adventist Academy there in Grand Rapids, Michigan, where we serve together faithfully at the Bethel Seventh-day Adventist Church. Pastor North joined the Lake Region Conference and served as pastor in the Michigan, Illinois, Indiana conferences, and then he went on to be the youth director for Lake Region Conference as well. Most recently, Pastor North served as the associate pastor at the Oakwood University Church. Before he was elected, God elevated him and blessed him in a mighty way. Listen, y'all, I want to celebrate my friends. Amen. I just want to celebrate them today. He is now the executive secretary of the Southwest region at Dallas in Dallas, Texas. And not only that, but he also serves as the associate pastor of the Dallas City Temple Seventh-day Adventist Church there as well. Pastor North loves to hang out with his family and his friends, theological discussions, and sports. Pastor North has a passion for authenticity, serving and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ and empowering and equipping and igniting people to pursue their God-given passion. His goal is to reach the world, to reclaim the lost, and restore the image of Jesus Christ through the transformational power of the Holy Spirit. Listen, man, there is no genuine brother like this brother right here. He is just a good, just hometown brother, funny. He is a great preacher, a people's person. I just thank God that he has allowed for Pastor North to be in my life and his family as well. They have a wonderful family, and we're excited to have him today. When he preaches, y'all better get with him. Come on, somebody, amen, get with him. The same way y'all get with me, get with him even more today as we celebrate a good and gracious God. Have y'all been blessed today by the mass choir today? I just want to shout out James Jackson and this band today. Can we celebrate the band as well today, y'all? We oftentimes don't get a chance to celebrate the band, but we're just excited to have each one of you all today. To those who came in as well, we want to welcome you once again, those that came in late to church today. We want to... Yeah, you're going to have to throw a little shade just for a second. But anyway, it's so good to see each one of y'all that came in today to church. I must recognize the executive treasurer of the Lake Region Conference today. It's so good to see you, Brother Kent Nichols, right there in the back. Amen. But go ahead and stand real quick, brother. It's good to see you today. God bless you. I see others that have come in. I can't see everybody, but God bless you today. Let's enjoy the preachment today. And as the choir sings, the next voice you hear will be Pastor Jason C. North. God bless you.
So this person needs no introduction, and she'll probably punch me after service because I did it. But she's not a part of the alumni of the Great Oakwood. Unfortunately, she went to Fisk. But she is an alumnus of this church, a daughter of this church. And so I'm going to invite my big sister, Danita Jones, to come and sing this song with us. The song is simple. I want to know him in the power of his resurrection. I want to know him as I live from day to day. I want to know him through my trials and my tribulations. Now, in the first song, we just got done talking about how God kept you. And then it says, I want to know him through the power of his word. Enjoy, y'all.
Know him and the power of his resurrection. Hallelujah. Oh, is there anybody willing to give God a little praise in this place today? Oh, that's pretty pathetic. Anybody willing to give God some praise in this place today? Did he wake somebody up this morning? Did he start you on your way? Has he been better to you than you could have been to yourself? I'm not trying to pump and prime you, but I'm just here to say thank you, Jesus. He didn't have to, but he did. And I just want to honor the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Somebody ought to say hallelujah to the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. I want to start by saying, what up, Huntsville? I went to school here, and came back, lived here, and I see so many faces that I recognize, and some of you I call my friends, and some of you I call my family. You all know who you are. I'm not going to try to point you out. I'm not going to hop around like my boy. It ain't going to happen, y'all. I'm going to move a little to the left, a little to the right. But when, you know, help me, Holy Ghost. I don't know about you. I'm looking forward to the second coming of Jesus. I don't know what happens when you get over 40. You can hurt yourself by thinking something. Talk about where did that come from? I didn't remember doing anything, but God is good, and one day this corruptible will put on incorruption. This mortal will put on immortality. Thank the choir. Come on, put your hands together for the choir on today. Praise team. My nephew Bryce, we all related up in this mug. I want to thank you for the pastor and first lady of this house. Come on, you can do a little better than that. We're talking about one of the hardest working, most genuine, loving, honest. He's a little younger than I am. Just a little wee younger. I ain't old yet, y'all. Just slow your roll. But he started in pastoral ministry before I did. And so even though he's a little younger, I look at him as a mentor in ministry. And everything he was doing, I was trying to do as well. And it just so happened that we were serving in some of the same cities at the same time, and I can honestly say it was some of the best moments in my ministry serving with, alongside, Dr. William Jeffrey Lee Sr. Amen. All right, let's get to the word, but before that I need to honor the lady of my life. I call her my American Express. For I try not to leave home without her. And on tomorrow, church family, we celebrate 22 years of marriage. First Lady Angie, the first lady of my life, I love you with all my heart. She's given me three wonderful children, and they not kids no more.
but we bless the name of the Lord. I need you to stand with me on today. We bring you greetings on behalf of the Southwest Region Conference. Y'all know Dr. Bird. Y'all know him. He's our president, Elder Philip Palmer. Another Lake Region product is our treasurer. We bring you greetings from the 21,000 members all across our five-state territory. Would you turn with me to the book of Luke, chapter 15? We're just going to spend a few moments talking about this son. Beginning in verse 11, I have the New King James Version of the Bible. And the Bible says, "Then he said, a certain man had two sons. Younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me a portion of goods that falls to me.' And so he divided to them his livelihood. Not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and wasted his possessions with prodigal or riotous living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land. He began to be in want. And then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country and sent him in the field to feed swine. He would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate. No one gave him anything. But when he came to himself," just nudge the person next to you, say, "Come on, come to yourself, come to yourself, come to yourself." Sometimes church folk be acting funny. You gotta come to yourself now. He would gladly have filled this. When he came to himself, how many of my father's servants have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise, go to my father. I say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of the hired servants.' And he arose, came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion." I said he had compassion. What would the church look like if we had just a little bit more compassion? "Ran and fell on his neck, kissed him. Son said to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring out the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his hand, sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here. Kill it. Let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead, is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to be merry." If I had to give this title, I'd just simply call it homecoming. Father, in the name of Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, do what you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Let all who believe say amen and amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. The Bible describes this young son as one who was a little impatient. I'm not sure what's wrong with this boy, but for one reason or another, he doesn't want to live in his daddy's house any longer. I don't know what's wrong with this boy. Maybe he's tired of getting up early on Saturday morning. I don't know what's wrong with this boy. Maybe he doesn't get a good breakfast before he goes to church. Maybe he gets rushed out the house for fear of somebody being late. I don't know what's going on with this boy. Maybe he's tired of wearing that adventurer uniform. I don't know what's going on with this brother. Maybe he's tired of being in the Pathfinder Club and all that marching and all of that knot tying and all that wearing that stiff uniform. I'm talking about myself. I'm talking about the young brother in the store. I don't know what's wrong with this brother. Maybe he's tired of every Friday he's got to shut things down an hour early to prepare for the Sabbath. I can't get no help in here today. Maybe he's tired.
tired of spending all day watching his parents sleep the Sabbath away while he's bored to death and going through his phone. I can't get no help in here today. Maybe he's tired of going to the school that doesn't have all the bells. I don't know what's wrong with this brother. But for one reason or another, the Bible says that he comes to his father. You need to understand he's between the age of 15 and 17 years of age. And he comes up to his dad. He rolls up on his dad and he says, "Dad, I want my inheritance right now." As a matter of fact, what he's saying, but without saying it, is he's, "Dad, I wish you would hurry up and die. So I can get what's coming to me." He didn't respect what all that his dad had done for him and thinking that life just gonna come easy. He demands his inheritance. Now, church, I don't know about you, but have one of my sons. I got two of them now, and if either of them had the mitigated gall to approach me talking about, "Dad, hurry up and die, and let me get what's coming to me," you would have to call Child Protective Services. As a matter of fact, if I had rolled up on my pop talking reckless, I probably still have the scar to this day from the left hook and the right cross I would have received at the point of me interjecting my discussion. But this father, church, you gotta listen to me. This father is a spiritual man. This father is connected to God. How do I know? Because his response is a spiritual response. I have to confess today that this father in the story is probably a lot more spiritual than me. The reality is he gives his youngest son his inheritance. He gives him a third of everything that he is entitled to. And the Bible doesn't say it explicitly, but the son probably gets it all down and liquidates it into cash. And this father is so spiritual that he understands that his son really doesn't belong to him. I'm trying to help a parent out in here today. He realizes and recognizes that children are an inheritance from the Lord. And ultimately, they are God's responsibility. I know I'm not that spiritual because, you know, listen, I don't know if I could just turn my kids over to God. And let me challenge the church today. I would believe that there would be more young people in church. Listen to me now. If parents would stop playing God, people much smarter than me, they tell you that up until about the age of 7, that a parent represents God to their child. And about 7 years old, they can begin to formulate an impression of who God really is. But some of us as parents still don't trust God with our children. So when they call us in trouble, they don't pray to God. They pray to you. And because you keep answering their prayers, why would they ever turn to him when they can just turn to you? This father's more spiritual than me, y'all. Y'all pray for me. I'm getting there. I'm going there. As a matter of fact, I have an app on my phone that I can detect where my children are anytime I want to look after them. Amen, somebody.
and they will quickly get a phone call if they turn off the ability. Do I have a witness in this place? First of all, you didn't pay for that phone. You're not paying for that phone. Turn your location. Help us, Lord. I see some of y'all got some spiritual growth to do as well. Uh-huh. Yeah. Dad is more spiritual because the Bible says that he gives his son his inheritance. Now, listen, even if I was as spiritual, I might let my kids go. Talking about give me what's mine. Now you can go. Oh, yeah. You can go. But anything I paid for will stay right here. Where's the organ when I need it? Hey! Those jeans are mine. That jacket is mine. That cell phone, sure enough. You be going out here like Job. Naked I came in. Naked I shall return. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You can go, but everything I bought is going to stay right here. But this dad not only lets him go, but has the spiritual maturity to give him his inheritance on the way out. Many of you know the story, but some of you don't. He goes, and what we used to say back then, he wows out. I see some of y'all. Oh, yes. Stop playing now. Some of y'all were here when I was here. The Bible says, puts it so eloquently, he wasted his possessions on prodigal living. That's so gentle, you know. I said, oh, what happened to your son? Well, he just wasted his possessions on prodigal living. No, he was going buck wild. The testimony of his older brother is that he took the money and he was spending it on prostitutes. That's what his brother said. But we know that he was out there. He was wiling out. And the Bible says that this rises a severe famine in the land. I'm here to declare to you that if you persist in living a rebellious lifestyle, that in God's purpose, in his will, he will allow a severe famine in your life. What am I saying? What I'm saying is he will allow you to hit rock bottom. Keep spending money like you want to and you'll be financially rock bottom. Keep treating people wrong, you'll be relationally rock bottom. Keep acting up emotionally, rock bottom. Some of us, God has had to lay on our backs physically, rock bottom. But it's an act of mercy. God ain't mad at you. He's trying to get a message to you, and he lets a severe famine in the land hit. You know, some of y'all know my story. I'm going to tell it anyway. You know, by the time I got to Oakwood, I had already gone to college for 2 years up north. But by the time I got down here, I had developed a habit. I see something familiar. It had to do with plant life. Now, it was never this green, but now let me tell y'all something. I'm from Berrien Springs, Michigan. Ain't but 3,500 people in the whole town. Okay, now your pastor is from a different zip code, about 8 miles down the road. That's where the thugs hang out. But I was raised in privilege. I'm not mad. My parents both have degrees. And listen, they laid it out for me, a silver spoon in my mouth. There was no reason for me to go the way of the path that I did. But like this young man, I was tired. I thought I was missing out on something. I thought that what I saw in the videos and what I heard on the songs, I want to experience that type of life. And I had developed this habit where we would get plant life. We would become what we call little botanists. And I'm trying to keep it G-rated, you know what I mean? Some of y'all be explaining stuff on the way home, like, Mom, Dad, botany. What was he talking about? Plant life. But I got down to Huntsville, Alabama. I wasn't no thug, y'all. Tasha, I wasn't no thug. We went to boarding academy and everything. No, I had a little dog. I had a good life. But I found myself hanging and engaged in a lifestyle I didn't really knew nothing about. I was trying to kick it, have a good time, and I moved down to Huntsville. And listen, I live, woo, help me, Lord. I live right around here. Uh-huh, over off of Torrance, uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Yeah. My house became the spot. And I began to traffic stuff from up north to down south. Not because I was trying to be no big time. I was just trying to support my habit. You know, it's interesting, the Bible says that he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pot. It's interesting how quickly the devil will take you down a hole you never thought you'd go in. You know, I went from, I'll try it to putting five on it. Then from five to quarter ounces. And so one day I'm in my little apartment, little one bedroom apartment down there. You know, there's a couple rows of apartments, and I was in my little one bedroom apartment, my play cousin and myself. And, they used to put a police officer in every apartment complex down here to keep the partying down, you know. And in mine, he lived right above me. I'll never forget it. His name was Officer Johnson. And we would call him OJ for short. And Officer Johnson used to work 3 to 11. We knew his schedule. Because right around 10:30, we would have to close the window so the vaporage would not escape. The fumes would remain inside so he couldn't catch it. But something happens when you do green stuff too long. You begin to forget things. Some of y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. Don't blame that memory on old age. Come on, tell the truth. Shame the devil. There's a couple brain cells that said bye-bye. But can I just testify what God can do with a couple good brain cells? And hallelujah. Don't give up. God can still work it out. So I'm getting there, church. I'm in the apartment. I hear, yeah. Stay with me, Doc. Stay with me. I'm in the apartment and it's now 11. The window's still open. And I hear. Now all you law enforcement, I don't know, did they teach you that knock? There's something about that knock. It's the police. I said, who is it? He said, Jay, I smell it. I looked at my cousin. I said, go flush it all. Let me tell you something. He had been to jail. I had not. I'm not going to last in jail. Don't let the size fool you. I will cry like a baby. Call my mama. Come get me. Oh, I don't belong in nobody's jail. I'm from Berrien Springs, y'all. We got two total stoplights in the whole town. I just got McDonald's 20 years ago. I mean, come on now. So he comes into the apartment. He says, Jay, I smell it. I said, listen, Doc, I'd heard the sweet sound of the toilet bloosh. My cousin came out of the toilet. He handcuffs us both. Sitting in my own little kitchen area, he says, I smell it. He begins looking in my cabinets. Where is it, Jay? Where is it? I said, man, it's all gone, Doc. It's all gone. And he gets on his radio, and he says something on his radio, and about 10 minutes later, there's a silence. All of a sudden, another car pulls up. It's got K and 9 on the side. All of a sudden, this mangy mutt comes running through my little apartment, church. He's sniffing around. He goes into my little bedroom, and I look at my cousin. I said, man, did you flush it all? And his head just... You see, church, my cousin was notorious for planning for the future. And what he would do is he would, once we were done partaking of the plant life, there would be these little things called roaches. Not the things that scurry. I know you're going to have a lot of explaining to do going home today. But he would compile all of them because what we discovered was the potency was in the remnant. Oh, I thought I had an Adventist church in here today. We discovered that once all that was gone, if we really wanted to fly like a bird, we would just put together for one last one. It was all the remnants of what we had. And the Holy Ghost dropped this on me. He said, that's the reason why the enemy hates this church, and he hates specifically our young people, because he knows that the most powerful agent is in the remnant. The most powerful part of our church is in the last remaining group. And he knows that if these young people would ever catch a little fire, that they would take this church to places we couldn't even imagine. That's why we got to get out of the way and train these young people and let the Holy Spirit move and quit trying to control them. They can reach people we can't reach. Because the power is in the remnant. Yeah. Well, I'm on my way to jail. I know. I look good today. Amen. God has blessed me anyhow. But I was on my way in the back of the squad car, and I resonated with this story. You see, in the midst of all that was going on, even being high and inebriated, I'm so glad that the Holy Spirit can still penetrate even through substances. God's Spirit somehow knows how to, and the stuff, listen to me, church, the stuff that I hated to learn as a young churchgoer began to come back to my memory. So I'm now in the squad car quoting scripture, talking about you'll never leave me, nor will you forsake me. I've been young, I'm still young, but I ain't never seen the righteous forsaken. No, listen, the stuff didn't even apply to me, but I didn't care, because the whole word of God I can claim as my own. I'm back there singing, trust and obey, for there's no... I know the police officer like, what is wrong with this brother? I'm going to jail. If we ever needed... See, church, they locked me up. They took my picture and took my fingerprints, took my belt. Some people bringing back memories. Yeah. Whew, I remember that. Took my shoelaces. I looked at the officer. I said, officer, why are you taking my shoelaces? He said, well, son, we don't want you to hang yourself. I said, do I look like I could hang from a pear? You see, when he came to himself, he says, how many of my father's servants, as I was sitting in that cell, one toilet, no doors, no stall, as the 25 other people were in that tank, I began to wish that I had been a better son. I gladly would have washed the dishes and gladly would have cut the grass and gladly would have kept my room straight. I'm trying to help somebody today. When they close those doors, clink, clink, it's one thing listening to it in a movie and on TV, but when it's for real, clink, 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 bam, and your freedom is gone. All I saw was a tired little payphone on the wall, and it's amazing how your friends scatter when you need a little financial assistance. I was calling everybody. Do you accept this call from Huntsville City Jail? Click, boo. Oh, yeah. He said, I will arise and go to my father. Now, the beauty of this story is not necessarily that the son comes to himself. And we love it, we celebrate it, we believe in it. But the beauty is in the father. The father does some key things I think will help us today as it relates to coming home or homecoming. First, as I have explained so earlier, is that dad, by faith, lets his son go. I know there's a mother, father, grandmother, a grandfather, auntie, uncle, you know, they out there, but you got to let them go. You got to turn them over to Jesus. You see, you don't come to yourself until you're by yourself. So the dad by faith lets his son go. But the Bible declares that as the son is coming home, The Bible says that the Father sees him a great way off. Now there are two applications to this that I believe that the Bible wants us to understand, discover today. And the first application is in Deuteronomy chapter 21. Y'all can look it up and fact check me when you go home. It says that if you have a rebellious child, the parents of the rebellious child, according to the Mosaic laws, they can take the rebellious child. Listen to me, young people. I didn't know this until I read it for myself. The rebellious parent can take the young child or the older child to the elders of the church. I mean, elders of Israel. And the elders will then commence to stoning the Bible says the evil child to death. See, had I read that, I wouldn't have clowned as a young person. Help me, Holy Ghost. If I'd have known they could kill, it wasn't legal, but it was biblical. And so the dad is eagerly looking for his son because he knows if the elders or the church folk get to his son before he does, that they may commence to try to kill him and take him out. So he has to run out there to protect his son. And what it tells me today is that there's some of y'all who are sitting in church today. You wouldn't be here if somebody had not shielded you from the rocks of negativity. They had not shielded you from all that stuff people were saying about you as you proceeded down to the altar call. If you knew how they really felt about you, you would have never came home. But God is so good that he goes out and he takes your punishment and he takes your blows and he covers you. But then the second application is simply this, that every day since his son has left and he's entrusted him to God, by faith, he's been anticipating his son coming home. Yeah. That's anticipation. I gave it to God, but I'm believing that God has the power, the ability, and the authority to bring it back to me. So he's anticipating a mighty move of God. Every day he's looking for his son. He sees him. The son tries to explain what has happened. And dad, I don't want to hear it. Let me help two or three church members. When somebody comes back to the Lord, stop asking them how they got into the situation that they may find themselves in. It's none of your business. Quit being nosy, quit being pokey, quit trying to get all up in everybody's stuff. Just love on them, receive them, shout hallelujah. This dad teaches us another principle. First, by faith, he let him go. By faith, now he's anticipating the son's return. The son returns, and now he says, put a ring on his hand, sandals on his feet. But then he uses this word, F-A-T-T-E-D. Yeah. Let that thing marinate in your spirit. F-A-T-T-E-D. The word is fatted. Yeah. See, when you go to the theological seminary, they teach you that anytime you see a word that is in the scriptures or in a narrative more than two or three times in a short matter of time, it's a word to be studied. So I got all of my theological tools together, and I began to study the word fatted. I was excited. I was excited because one day I looked in the mirror and I said, you know, Lord, I'm a little fatted. What didst thou sayest about fatted things? And I, look, listen, here's what I discovered. Oh my goodness. Here, you, are you ready? Oh, y'all, are y'all ready? Oh my goodness. So the word fatted means something that gets fat. I was just as disappointed as you are. I thought I was special. I had killed the diet and everything. I was going to be joyous in my fatted condition. But then the spirit said, no, brother. This animal is not just any animal. See, not only by faith has dad let his son go, and by faith he's been looking and anticipating his return. And along with anticipation of his return, he's been engaging in preparation with fattening up this particular animal for the celebration. See, now I know, I don't know what Adventist church you grew up in, but the one I grew up in, you could barely whisper a prayer, you know. All they used to do, you could wave your bulletin or wave your handkerchief. And if it got too excited, somebody might tap you on your shoulder and say, we don't do that here. I know we've come a mighty long way, but they would say, we don't do that here. All that shouting and all that hollering, it don't take all that. Yeah. See, Adventists, we will tolerate when we think that celebration is spontaneous, but if we in our imagination begin to believe that it has been rehearsed or somehow choreographed, we think it's disingenuous, and that's not real praise. God doesn't want that type of praise. I even believe, Dr. Lee, that at some point in time, if we would have been around during the triumphal entry, during this past week, if some of y'all were there, some of us were there, and Jesus, as he's riding on a colt into Jerusalem, he breaks out into uncontrollable crying over the city that he loves. He begins to weep uncontrollably. I believe if some of us were there, we would have looked at Jesus and said, Jesus, it don't take all that. Get your emotions under control, Jesus. This is an intellectual church, and I don't find nowhere in Scripture where you can be hollering and crying and acting up. Yeah. But the theology of the fatted calf lets me know that God enjoys a pre-rehearsed praise. That God likes a choreographed praise. That God likes when we prepare for the celebration. See, there's anticipation. That anticipation is for a celebration. But we got to learn how the celebration works even before any manifestation. Let me help a couple people up. I love sports. Yes, I wish I could still play them, but it just so happens I'm out of the sports business. Just somehow how my copay is set up, I had to leave it alone for a while. But I learned something in athletic sports that I watched the game, and when they score, or when they make a great play, or when they get the victory, there is many times this choreographed celebration. Have you seen it?
Yeah. Sometimes it's two or three with a little funky handshake together. A door that has sometimes it's a whole group of 11. Sometimes the entire defense will celebrate. And I began to ask myself, how in the world, in that moment, does everybody know what to do? And then God said, well, that's because they have anticipation for the celebration, even before any manifestation. I said, God, you got to break it down. You got to help me. He said, well, when they get back to practice on Tuesday, a group of them begin to come together and say, how are we going to celebrate the victory that we are about to receive? And so they will get their dance together. They will get their handshake together, their moves together, so that they are not caught off guard when what they have prepared for actually happens. So I'm wondering today, Dr. Lee, I wanna take some executive privileges today. And I want to encourage the First Church of Huntsville, First Seminary Church of Huntsville, to select a fatted calf coordinator. Yeah. And this person's sole responsibility, Doc, is to gather whosoever will in anticipation of what God is going to do on Sabbath. On Sunday, we gonna put our ideas together. We believe there's gonna be a mighty move of God this Sabbath. Why? Because Bryce is leading the praise team. We gonna leave a mighty move of God. Why? Because the choir is singing. We gonna see a mighty move of God. Why? Because Dr. William Lee is gonna preach the word. And so we need to get our act together in advance of what God is about to do. So I want First Church to help me out today. Maybe there are two or three of you who are willing just to put your hands together in anticipation for a mighty move of God. There are some young people who you are praying for, who you don't need deliverance, and you want to say right now, God, I know you can. God, I know you will. I want to know if there's 10 other people willing to stand on your feet and just wave your hands in anticipation. Get your celebration ready for what God is about to do. I wondered if there's 30 more people willing to just say yes, yes, say yes of what God is about to do in the life of your son, your daughter, your niece, your nephew, your grandbaby. He can do it. He's gonna do it. He can make a way out of the way. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. The Father sees his son and says, get the fatted calf, y'all, because we about to party. We gonna have a good time. And let me tell you something. This is not the only homecoming that I'm excited about. Because 2,000 years ago, on Friday, Jesus died. On the Sabbath, he slept. And early Sunday morning, he got up and he secured my eternal homecoming party. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. One day we'll be going home. One day, no more aches and pains. One day, no more drama. One day, no more bills.
One day, God's gonna save our children. Thank you, Jesus. Isaiah 49:25. I claim this. It says, he that contends with you, I will contend with, and I will save your children. They don't have to be biologically yours. But God is orchestrating a homecoming. They can be tweens or teens or young adults. They might be full-grown adults, senior adults. But God is orchestrating a great homecoming. You know how I know? Because I'm a living witness. So I play something real soft. I'm in the seminary. Yeah, how did I get from the jail cell to the seminary? Well, Dr. Lee, you're going to have to bring me back. See you next time. I'm in class, and my father taught at the seminary after he retired. So I'm sitting in class one day, and actually really it's the first day, and the professor, he says, he's going through the roll, and he's calling names, and he says, Jason North. And I say, here. And he says, Jason North. I said, here. He says, Jason North. So I'm looking around. I'm saying, is there another one in the room? I'm Jason North. He starts getting choked up. So I'm thinking to myself, I didn't do it, brother. I didn't. It's not my fault. His tears start to come down his face. And he says, for the last few years, every day, your dad and I would call your name. In prayer. And to see you sitting here studying to be a pastor is nothing but the goodness of God. He said, but that's not why I'm crying. He said, I'm crying because my son is still out there. But because you're here, I have hope that God will do just what he said he would do. That God is a promise keeper. That he cannot lie. That he will protect my kids even if they wild it out. God will do just what he said. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And so there's a mother. There's a father today. And you were tempted. There's a spouse. There's a parent. There's a sibling. You were tempted to give up. But God brought me all the way here
to encourage somebody, say, don't give up. God's not finished with them yet. It doesn't matter how bleak the situation might be. God can bring them home. I believe this church is due a great homecoming. I want to tell you, parents, as I take my seat today, when you see your wayward person, they know the Bible maybe better than you. Quit tripping on them. And when you see them, get happy. Don't look at where they are. Look at where they're going to end up. And that will give you the ability to say, I don't care what you're into, God's got something for you. There's a mother, there's a father, there's an auntie, there's an uncle, there's a grandma, grandpa, there's a spouse, there's a sibling. And today you simply need to be the intercessor. You need to, by faith, let them go. By faith, anticipate their return. By faith, get the fatted calf. Get the celebration ready. Because they're coming back. I declare unto you that before it's too late, they're coming back. Do you believe that today? Do you receive that today? I declare in the name of Jesus that God's going to bring them back. That God's going to save and fight for his children. If you need to move, just come on down right now. We want to pray over you. We want to pray for you. We want to pray that God moves in a mighty and miraculous way. You might not live to see it, but when you are around the sea of glass, you will see your child. Hallelujah. Just press forward, press forward. Hallelujah. If you have pressed forward, I just need you to put a hand on the shoulder. If you're comfortable enough to join hands or join arms, lock arms. I believe that even in this moment, we can touch and agree that whatever's done in heaven will be done here on earth. I believe it. I got some siblings. I need God to move on. Maybe there's somebody out there. You living a little wild. And today you want to take a risk on God and say, God, listen, I've tried everything else. Let me try you. If that's you, would you just lift your hand right now? We want to acknowledge you. We want to pray for you. We see you today. Maybe somebody else wants to be baptized. You want to go down in the watery grave of baptism. You say, God, I need a new start. I need to come up in the newness of life. Jesus, possessing my entire being. If that's you, keep your hand high. You want to be baptized today. Say, God, you did it for that preacher dude. Do it for me. Just lift your hand high. We want somebody's going to come next to you. We want to prepare you for the next baptism on today. Hallelujah. Any moment you feel the desire that, God, I need to go down the watery grave, come up in the newness of life. Please let one of the leaders know. Let your parents know. Say, God, I want to be in that great homecoming. Father, in the name of Jesus right now, there's some folk who done came forward. There's some specific people on their heart. God, we've agonized. We've prayed. And so, God, we need you to move right now. Disturb them right now. Lord, I get scared every time I pray this, but even allow them to hit rock bottom so they would look up and call on the name of Jesus. Oh God, we thank you for not giving up on us. When we felt like throwing in the towel, God, you've kept us. You've uplifted us. Oh God, you've changed us. You've transformed us. Lord, there are those who've lifted their hands and say, I need a fresh start today. Your word declares if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, God. Somebody else said, I want to be baptized. I want to join the household of faith right here at First Church. And so, God, I pray that these decisions are sealed by the Holy Ghost unto the day of eternity. Lord, we just need an increase of faith today that you do what you promised, that you will contend with him that contends with us, and that you will save our loved ones. Save them is our prayer. God, will we be careful to give you all the honor, all the praise, all the glory that is due only you. God, we will prepare for the celebration. We will go out here, God, thanking Jesus for what you are about to do. It's in the worthy and wonderful name of Jesus that we do ask and declare all of these blessings and promises. Let the people of God who believe say amen and amen and amen. God bless you on today. God bless you. God bless you real good.
Has come over me. praise God and worship Him for this wonderful change that He has brought to us today, being renewed in the spirit of the true and the living God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to honor you and worship you for coming and being with us, abiding with us, for you sending your servant to feed us today from your table. We're thankful, Lord. Now bless us as we leave and go through this week to remember that you are covering over us and that you will see us safely our journey home. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you so very much. Hey, before we let you go, can we just affirm the preacher today, everybody? Can we just thank God today for Pastor North? Praise God for the word of God. Our souls have been fed, and we are happy as we leave this place today. God bless you on this resurrection weekend. I want to recognize pastors, if there are any pastors in the congregation today, would you please stand? We want to honor you on this weekend, all pastors. God bless you. God bless you, sir. God bless you. Others, God bless you. It's so good to see. God bless you today. God bless each one of these men today of God. Were you all blessed by the Mass Choir today? Amen. Thank you all so very much. Amen. We're going to leave this place. Come and shake Pastor North's hand in the back as you all are dismissed. They're going to usher you out, but you got plenty enough time still to get where you're going. Amen. God bless you. Communion on next Sabbath. God bless you. Thank y'all for joining us at First Church. Hey, stay by. The choir's going to sing right now. God bless you in Jesus' name.
As you're leaving out, why don't you sing this with us? It's an old Timothy Wright cut. It says, for the rest of my life, I'll serve the Lord. Here we go for the rest. For the rest of my life.
No matter what.
Amen.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us right here at First Church. We were so blessed by the service today. We started a little early so that we can get out so that those who want to go to the Von Braun, they may do so. So we are excited. We want to thank our pastor for inviting a special guest, Pastor Jason North, who gave a wonderful, wonderful word. It was such inspiring and gave us hope for our future. And it was so wonderful for him to be so transparent in showing how the love of God saved him. And so we're grateful for that. Just a few reminders of the different things that are going on. Youth Nature Sabbath is April 27th, and the deadline to register or to sign up is April 20th. So stay close to the website. Also stay close to Facebook and YouTube for those information. I have a special guest that wants to share something with you.
Good evening. My name is Jeremiah Hurt, and I'm from the youth choir. And I'm inviting you to join the youth choir. We have practice every Wednesday at 5:15, and we need sopranos the most. So come join us this Wednesday at 5:15.
Wonderful, wonderful. You heard it from our very own youth, Jeremiah. Youth choir rehearsals. So if you're interested in that, feel free to come out for that. And just remember, all of the other announcements are in your bulletin, also on the website and on Facebook. Again, we were glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Happy Sabbath.
At First Seventh-day Adventist Church in Huntsville, healing happens one heart at a time. As a part of the World Church, through Christ's instruction, we evangelize to our community through service, education, and personal relationships. God has allowed our ministry's reach to extend to worshipers beyond this region. In fact, we welcome and worship with thousands of people online and in person weekly. Evangelistic efforts, like most endeavors, require financial support. Your giving falls into one of two categories, tithe and offering. Tithe is a 10% of your financial gain that is set aside to further God's work. Your local church receives and passes along all your tithe contributions to be distributed to various conferences and divisions for regional and global ministry support. Your offering is an expression of gratitude that remains with the local church. These financial gifts pay for the ongoing expenses, bills, and maintenance of the church and fund all ministry initiatives. It is because of your offering that the church doors remain open, our community assistance programs remain dynamic and effective, resources continue to be made available to the public, and Christ's message reaches the far corners of the world. To help further God's work, both internationally and locally, through your tithe and offering respectively, here are ways to give. For further information on how to give, please visit firstscachurch.com/give. Thank you for your continued support. We can only reach the world because of you.